A 2-cubic-foot tank contains saturated refrigerant 134A at 160 psia. At this initial state, 20% of the refrigerant by volume is in the liquid phase. A valve on top of the tank is now opened, and vapor is discharged from the tank. When no more liquid remains in the tank, the valve is closed. Heat is transferred during this process such that the pressure remains constant. Determine the total heat transfer for this process. Let's begin this discharging problem with an appropriate illustration. We're told that we have a tank and that the tank has a volume of 2 cubic feet and that the tank contains the refrigerant 134A. Now, let's just let 1 equal the initial state and 2 equal the final state for this particular problem. And it is a discharging problem, so we know we're also going to have an exit state. So let's just let E equal the exit state. Now, we're given the initial pressure. So P1 is known to us as 160 psia. We're then told that at this initial state, 20% of the refrigerant by volume is in the liquid phase. Now, that would mean that 80% is in the vapor phase, but that's not the quality. We need the quality to find our thermodynamic properties, but we don't want to confuse a volume percentage with a mass percentage. So we will use this information to find the quality, but don't assume that the quality is 80%. It's not. Anyway, at state point 1, we would note that it's 20% liquid. But again, this is by volume. Now, further it says that there's a valve that's now opened on top of the tank and the vapor is discharged from the tank. Keep in mind that as we have a two-phase mixture in the tank, the saturated liquid portion of the mixture has a much greater density, so it settles to the bottom of the tank. And the saturated vapor with the lower density has filled the top portion of the tank, so it's really only the saturated vapor that's going to be leaving this particular tank. It says that when no more liquid is remaining in the tank, then the valve is now closed. Further, it says that heat is transferred during this process such that the pressure remains constant. So that tells us a lot about the system. Okay? First of all, we would note that since the pressure remains constant, then P2 is the same as P1 of 160 psia. Additionally, since it's only the vapor that leaves the top of the tank and the pressure remains constant within the tank, then the pressure of the discharge, that is the pressure of the exit, has also got to be 160 psia. Furthermore, we would note that since it says when no more liquid remains in the tank, the valve is closed. In other words, when the last of the liquid has vaporized, we get to the saturated vapor point. So point 2 is also a saturated vapor. And since we're only removing the saturated vapor portion through that exit stream, and that is always a saturated vapor, and it's always at the same pressure, then E is also going to be a saturated vapor. So we really know a lot about this particular system. Anyway, we're trying to find the total amount of heat transfer, and that's our unknown for this particular problem. Now, to solve this problem for heat transfer, we clearly need to use the first law. And for a discharge problem, the first law tells us that the heat transfer equals M2U2 minus M1U1, and then plus the mass that exits times the enthalpy at the exit. So if we can determine all three thermodynamic states and the masses, we should be able to find the heat transfer. Now, let's see about doing that. First of all, we would note that the continuity equation applies. As such, the amount of mass that exits the system simply has to be the difference between the amount of mass that we start with and the amount of mass that we end with. So ME equals M1 minus M2. Further, we would note that in order to find the appropriate masses, we need to know something about the specific volume. So in order to find the mass at state point 2, we're just going to look at the total volume and then divide that by the specific volume at 2. With regards to state point one, it's just a little bit more complicated. We would note that we're not given the quality, we need to find the quality, and to do that we need to find our mass. So let's just note that the initial mass is actually a mixture of the mass that's in the liquid phase plus the mass that's in the vapor phase. So in other words, this is just going to be mf plus mg. Now, how do we find the mass of the liquid or the vapor portion of this two-phase mixture? Well, we know the volume fractions. So if we can find the volume of the saturated liquid and divide that by the specific volume at point one, that's going to be the mass of the liquid. We find the volume of the vapor and divide that by the specific volume of the vapor, that's going to be the mass of the vapor. And that will then allow us to find M1. Now, we're also going to need the quality, so let's just keep in mind that the quality at point one is just going to be the mass of the vapor divided by the total mass at point one. And as we see directly above, the mass of the vapor is just the volume of the vapor divided by the specific volume of the vapor. So now let us proceed with this particular problem. And in fact, to begin with, why don't we just write down all the thermodynamic property data we're going to need. Clearly we need specific volume data at initial and final state, as well as internal energy at initial and final states, and we're going to need the enthalpy at the exit state. So we'll start at point one. So at P1, we know it's a two-phase mixture, so we're going to have to go into the pressure saturation table, which is A12E. VF is listed as 0.01413 cubic feet per pound. And VG is listed as 0.29316 cubic feet per pound mass. And then we're also going to need the internal energy. So ultimately we're going to need UF, and that's 48.10 BTUs per pound. And we're also going to need UFG, and this is listed as 60.40 BTUs per pound. Moving on to state point two at P2, we know this is a saturated vapor, so we're still in the saturation tables. So V2 is going to be VG. So VG is 0.29316, just like above, cubic feet per pound mass. And we're also going to need U2, which is UG. And UG is 108.50 BTUs per pound. And then lastly, at the pressure of the exit, well, it's still a saturated vapor, we're still in the same table, A12E. So here, H at the exit, which is HG, is going to be 117.18 BTUs per pound. So now as we continue, let's find our mass and quality at point one. So back to our mass equation. So M1 is going to be the volume of the liquid over the specific volume of the liquid. So this is 0.2 times 2 cubic feet. And this is then divided by 0.01413 cubic feet per pound. And then we have the vapor portion, so this is 80% by volume. So this is 0.8 times 2 cubic feet divided by the specific volume of the vapor portion of the mixture, 0.29316 cubic feet per pound. And this is going to give us the initial mass as 13.56 pound mass. Now let's find the mass of the vapor at point one. Actually, this is this equation directly above. We don't need to rewrite it. We go through the math, and there we get 6.48 pounds mass. And now we can find the quality at point one. The quality at point one then is just the vapor mass divided by the total mass. And that's going to give me an initial quality of 0.4779. Now we can use this quality in order to find the internal energy at one. So U1 is going to equal UF, which is 48.1, plus the quality 0.4779 times UFG, which is 60.4. And this gives me the internal energy at point one then of 76.96 BTUs per pound mass. Now let's find the mass at point two. So the mass at point two is the total volume of 2 cubic feet divided by the specific volume, which is 0.29316. So this gives me the final mass in the system as 6.822 pounds mass. And now we can find the mass that leaves the system. Again, that's just the initial minus the final mass. So that's going to be 13.56 minus 6.822. And that's going to give me the exit mass of 6.736 pounds mass. So now we have all of our data. We have mass data, we have internal energy and enthalpy data. Let's finish up this problem then by finding the heat transfer. So we have M2 U2, so 6.822 pounds mass times 108.5 BTUs per pound mass. We subtract from that M1 U1, so 13.56 pounds mass times 76.96 BTUs per pound mass. And then we add to this MEHE, so 6.736 times 117.18 BTUs per pound mass. And this gives me 486 BTUs.